Well, good evening. I'm not sure if everybody is here yet, but I like to start on time to reward those of you who did come on time and some of you who arrived 45 minutes early. Yes. but they had first choice at the desserts, so there was a benefit for them. So welcome to my first client seminar since November of 2019. And the last time some of you were at one of my seminars, we talked about taxes, and we're going to talk about taxes again tonight. We also had a performance by my son, Cameron Douglas Graham, who sang some of his opera songs. Tonight he is also singing some opera songs, but he is at the rehearsal at the Jubilee Auditorium for the opera this weekend, Tosca. So he will not be performing for you tonight. I'll put a plug in for him. If you want to see him, you can go on Saturday night to the opera. As many of you know, this has been a kind of a bad year for stocks. We're going to talk about what you might want to do about that, if anything. I should make an introduction of myself. Most of you know who I am. I was talking up here. But there will be other people talking today. So I'm Ron Graham, and I own Ron Graham & Associates, financial planning firm. Taylor Zimmerman was at my last presentation in November. He's still working in my office. Sheila Hawkins is here, and she works out of my office. Maddie is our receptionist. Say hi, Maddie. There we go. Maddie, I think, was the one who's responsible for the desserts. So when you go past her, you say, wow, thanks. This is great. This is way better than what Ron puts on. And we're going to have Evan Mercer talk about Cardinal, talk about the various markets. I'm going to talk a little bit about the tax side of what's happening today. And Evan will talk about some of the opportunities in the equity markets. I think I sent you an email telling you what the statistics were for the year-to-date returns. That was back in June. The typical balanced fund at that time was down about 15%. Well, we now have some of the statistics for September, the third quarter, and now a balanced fund year-to-date is down 17%. So we're not going in the right direction in terms of you wanting your investments to go up in value. So again, is there something that you can do about the situation? I'm going to talk about three areas that, from a tax perspective, you can be aware of. The first thing that we might look at is what's called tax loss selling. If some of your investments have gone down, you may sell them and create a capital loss that can be used to offset capital gains from the past 3 years or forward into the future. We're going to talk about making withdrawals from your tax deferred plans, whether they're RRSPs or RRIFs. If you make a withdrawal in kind, that is taking the actual stocks out of your portfolio, is now a good time to be doing that. And most often when I mention that to clients, they say, oh no, the market's down, I don't want to do that. Well, actually, you might want to, and I'll show you why. And the third thing we'll talk about is tax-efficient investing, which sounds a lot like my last presentation in November, but we will talk about the benefits of taking the money out of your RRSP and what do you do with that money once it's outside of your RRSP. I am sure that many of you are looking at higher GIC rates and thinking, ooh, is now the time to cash in my stocks and buy GICs because I can get 4.5% or 5% on a GIC. And I will show you that some of the stocks that you could own or maybe already own are paying dividends in that 4% to 5% range. So there's no difference in the amount of income that may be produced between some stocks and GICs, but there is a big difference in two things. First, the tax consequences of dividends versus interest, and secondly, the potential for the recovery of your stocks. So if your stocks have gone down 10%, then presumably they can increase 10%. If you sell your investments when the market's gone down 10% and buy GICs, those GICs will not recover that 10% loss. So we're going to take a look at a couple of things in relation to both the markets and some of your reactions to that. So markets have been choppy. What does that mean? Volatile. Markets have gone up and down. My frustration in the press is that when they talk about volatility, they always talk about negative volatility. Stocks have gone down. It's volatile out there. Well, to me, volatility goes in both directions. You can't have capital gains unless there's the possibility of capital losses. Right now, we may have some capital losses, or you may have capital gains that are just not as big as they were back in January. That's a different issue, because we can talk about what you might do with capital losses, but if your investments have just gone down, they're still above what you bought them for, there's no tax benefit of creating a capital gain unless you think that the government's going to change tax rates on capital gains, which is a discussion for a different night. I haven't included that in this discussion. So let's take a look at how you approach money. You have put money aside, you've invested it. What is that money doing for you? Is it money that you need today? And if so, it probably shouldn't have been in the stock market. I generally suggest that if you're going to use your principal in the next 1 to 2 years, that money should not be in the stock market. It should be in short-term GICs or high-interest savings accounts or something else. So presumably, the money that you have in the stock market is not needed today. Is it creating income for you, and are you living off that income? And if so, income has continued. Most of the stocks that I follow have not reduced their dividend, and in many cases have increased their dividend since last year. So you may actually be making more income this year than you were last year, assuming that you didn't sell any of your investments. So if you don't need the money, then we're just going to have to accept that the market goes up and down. If you're collecting the income, that's great. That income is continuing. If you don't need the income and that income is being reinvested in more stocks, if you are in a dividend reinvestment plan, then each dividend that you receive is now buying more of those stocks at this lower and lower price. So in theory, that's a good thing. Doesn't feel good, but technically, it's a good thing from a financial perspective. I've talked about dividend aristocrats. Some of you have dividend aristocrats in your portfolio. Some of you have a dividend aristocrat ETF. In Canada, a dividend aristocrat is a stock that has increased its dividend at least 5 years in a row. And there are some stocks in Canada that have increased their dividend for 25 years. I think ATCO has increased theirs for about 40 years. So every year, they are increasing their dividend. Those are good stocks to own, even in this inflationary environment, because they can sometimes pass on their costs. If you're a regulated utility, you can pass on those costs to your customers. That causes inflation, but the company makes more money, and the company can then afford to pay a bigger dividend, and they can increase that dividend over time. Now, if you are still working, now you may have some extra money that you can invest. And it is tempting to say, well, GICs are 4.5, but no risk. But you can also buy stocks that pay 4.5 with the risk that the market's going to go down further, right? Because that's a possibility. We don't know when the bottom is going to be in the market. I'd like to say we're closer to the bottom than we are to the top, meaning that it's likely still going to further down, but not as much further down as what has already fallen. trying to time that bottom of the market is really difficult. I'll let Evan tell you how to do that because I'm not very good at it. I bought some Emira yesterday, and today they're down about 3%. So I'm not the one to tell you when the bottom is or what to do about it when it gets there. So let's talk about some of the things that we can do. I've got some examples here. Those examples were based on information that I had back in September when I was creating this. And I could have spent all day today updating those numbers, but I didn't because the concept is still the same. If you had purchased stocks late last year or early this year, then you paid a premium for those stocks. You bought them when they were high. You may have had other stocks that you've owned for years and years, but those stocks that you bought late last quarter or early this quarter, they are probably worth less now than when you bought them. Is there something that we can do about that? Well, we can't go back and change that. We can't say, well, let's pretend not to buy those. But what we may be able to do is create some benefit for you in that if you have sold some of your investments over the last 3 years and created capital gains, at least showing on your tax return, then this year you might be able to sell some of your investments that have gone down in value, create what's called a capital loss. So you've lost money. If you don't have any other capital gains this year to apply those losses against, because you first net your losses against this year's gain, but if you've got a net loss this year, then you can apply to have that loss carried back against your profits in 2019, 2020, or 2021. So the first thing we need to do is find out if you made any profit in those years. If you're not a trader, you may not have created any capital gains in 19, 20, or 21. If you're dealing with a broker, they may have sold some of your investments in 19, 20, or 21. They may have bought some other investments earlier this year, and so it would be a time to ask them, are there any capital losses in my portfolio now, and should I realize those losses? Oh no, don't sell now because the market's down. Well, exactly, that's why I want to sell it, so that I can create this capital loss and apply that against past capital gains. Now, if you sell those stocks now, then what happens if the market turns around and goes right back up the day after you sell it? I sold Netflix yesterday, and today it's up 5%. So don't ask me when to sell either. Thankfully, these are small positions, but the point is we can't know the future. We don't know which way the market's going to go tomorrow, next day, and so on. So this is an opportunity of creating a capital loss, but we do need to be aware that if the market changes, if the market goes back up the day after we sell it, then we're going to feel bad about that. So is there a way that we can arrange to avoid that bad feeling? So the benefit is I can sell some investments now to create this loss. If I've got capital gains in past years, I can effectively refile my tax returns for those years and delete those capital gains, and then I'll get a refund of some of the taxes that I paid in the past. So the first thing we need to do is look at your tax returns to see if, in fact, you did have any capital gains in those past years. Now, when I'm doing tax returns for my clients, I simply look at the five-year report, and yep, in 2019 they made this much money, in 2020 they made that much money, so I know how much they can apply to their capital gains in those past years. You may need to look back on your 2020, 2019, 2021 tax return to see, gee, did I have any capital gains? If so, then there's an opportunity to get back some of the taxes that you paid back then. Second thing, do I have any losses? And if I have losses, how big are they? Is it worthwhile creating these losses? If you are dealing with a discount broker and you're managing your portfolio yourself, and it costs you $9.99 to sell the investment, another $9.99 to buy an investment, it's probably pretty cheap for you to make that transition. Did something happen to my mic? It feels, okay, great. Now, if you're dealing with a full service broker and it's going to cost you 2 or 3% to sell your investment and another 2 or 3% to buy it back, then it has to be a really big capital gain to make it worthwhile going through those transaction costs. If you're paying an advisor based on assets under management, so a fee-based account, then the fee is the same. You get unlimited transactions, so they can sell this, buy that, and it doesn't cost you any more to create this capital loss. So each person might be in a slightly different position, including some, I don't have any money outside of my RRSP, so this doesn't apply. But if you do have money outside of your RRSP, there's an opportunity here to create that capital loss and apply that loss back against other capital gains in the past. So when you're doing your tax return for 2022, so that will be March, April of 23, there's a form that you fill in, Schedule T1A, and you will just identify which year you want to apply the losses to. Is it 2019, 2020, 2021? How much of the loss do you want to apply against each of those years? And obviously you can't claim more loss than what you had in gains in those years. So again, you have to figure out what those gains were. Now, you've sold that investment, and again, what happens if it goes back up? Well, I guess I should just buy it right back. And the answer is no, you can't do that. The government has a system that tries to keep track of people who are kind of bending the rules here, creating a capital loss, but then buying the same thing back, and then really I haven't lost anything because I still own those same investments. So the government calls this a superficial loss rule. So you're creating a superficial loss. You didn't really have that loss because you still have those investments, and when they go back up, then maybe you didn't have any loss. So to avoid that superficial loss rule, you have to not own that particular stock for 30 days, or that particular investment, because it could be an exchange-traded fund, could be a mutual fund, but you can't own that same investment for the next 30 days. And this includes your RRSP, your TFSA. So I say, oh, I'm going to sell my Bank of Nova Scotia in my non-registered account, but I'm going to buy it in my RRSP because I really, really like it. The government might catch that, and so they consider that to be a superficial loss because you still own the Scotiabank shares, it just happens to be in a different account. So if that happens, then the government just denies that capital loss. They say, you didn't really have that capital loss. What happens if you bought your Scotiabank at 100, sold it for 80, and bought it back for 80, then they're going to tell you that your new adjusted cost base of your Scotiabank shares are $100, the same that you paid for the very first set of shares. So we don't want to do that, but you can buy a similar stock. If you sell Scotiabank, you can buy Bank of Montreal. They happen to be both banks, and presumably if banks do well in the future, then if Scotiabank goes up tomorrow, probably Bank of Montreal will go up tomorrow. So you have the opportunity of creating the loss in one stock and buying a very similar stock at the same time, the same day if you want, so that if the market does recover, then you're going to get that recovery, although it would be in a slightly different stock. So my example is Scotiabank and Bank of Montreal. If we're dealing with exchange-traded funds, XGRO is a portfolio provided by BlackRock, iShares, growth portfolio, so 80% stocks, 20% bonds. Vanguard has exactly the same portfolio, but because it's a Vanguard portfolio, not an iShares portfolio, if you sell your iShares portfolio, you get your capital loss. If you buy the Vanguard portfolio, it's going to do exactly what the iShares portfolio will do in the future. So you're exchanging identical investments, but they happen to be provided by different companies, iShares or Vanguard. So the superficial loss rules don't apply in that case because they are different investments. And if you do decide to wait for 30 days, then you may find that the shares of the company that you bought might have gone up in value, and so you've kind of lost out on that recovery. On the other hand, the market might go down further, and then you'll have an opportunity of buying that thing back at an even lower price, which is maybe not what you're looking for, but that's a possibility. So let's take a look at Scotiabank. Let's pretend that you bought it the high this year, January 16th. You paid $93.34 for 250 shares. I don't know why I figured 250, but it sounds like a good one. $23,335 is what it cost you. If you had sold them back in September, you would have gotten $17,812. Scotiabank from January to September was down 25%. I've got a capital loss of $5,522.50. If I'm in the 36% tax bracket, we'll talk a little bit more about what those tax brackets are, but if you're making over 100,000 but less than 134,000, you're in the 36% tax bracket. So you could apply that against previous year's tax returns and we'll get a refund of $993 plus interest from the government. Now, what do I do with that money? Well, I could go buy some Bank of Montreal shares. Bank of Montreal was $149 in January, down to $88 now, so it's down 15%. Well, that's not quite as far down as Scotiabank, and presumably, if they just go back to where they were, then Bank of Montreal won't go up as much as Scotiabank will, unless there's other reasons why Scotiabank went down more than Bank of Montreal. So I looked for another stock, and CIBC is down about 23%. So if you think that both Bank of Nova Scotia and CIBC are not as good as Bank of Montreal, that's why they went down so much, then you can buy another not as good stock, CIBC. So when the market rebounds, then maybe CIBC will go up more than Bank of Montreal. You can wait and buy Scotiabank. I looked at the August price of Scotiabank. It was $81.25. Today, Scotiabank's 65. So you probably should have waited your 30 days to buy it back. But we know that now. I didn't know that when I was making the presentation up. So there you go. Now, if you were using XGRO as an example, back in January, it was trading at $26. It's now trading, or last week or last month was trading at $22, so it was down 13%. That $3,400 capital loss would save you about $612 in tax. You could exchange that for VGRO, which has gone down 13%, or ZGRO, which is Bank of Montreal's equivalent. It's down 13%. Oh my goodness, they're down exactly the same amount because they are exactly the same investments, just provided by different providers. So if the money is outside of your RRSP, you can create these capital losses possibly and use those losses to reduce your taxes from previous years. If you don't have losses over the last 3 years, then you can carry those losses forward and use them against future capital gains. I'll make a plug right now. I won't talk about this much more, but as I mentioned, there some people believe that the government may increase the tax rate on capital gains by increasing the inclusion rate. Right now, only one half of your capital gain is included on your tax return. And if you listen to the NDP, they would want 3/4 of that capital gain included on your tax return. And if that happens, then the tax rate on capital gains will be higher in the future. If you create the capital losses now, then if they do increase tax rates on capital gains in the future, they will adjust your capital losses to be equivalent of 3/4 of next year's gains or whenever they make the changes. So I don't know if the government's going to make those changes, but if you think that they might, there were certainly people earlier this year that were selling their investments because they thought the tax rate was going to go up. They did go up, and or they did not go up, and that's why they've got potentially capital gains from earlier this year. They might want to offset those gains with losses now. But if your stock is in your RRSP, what can we do? Well, if the money is in a RRIF, you have to take a certain amount out every year. You can withdraw in kind, meaning instead of cashing in your investment and taking out cash, you can just withdraw the investments that are inside of your RRSP or RRIF. Obviously, there's taxes that will have to be paid on the amount that you withdraw, but there's taxes to pay whether you take out cash or whether you take out shares of BCE. So there's no difference in the amount of tax, it's just a difference of what you chose to take out of that particular account. If you're taking money out of a RRIF and it's the minimum amount that you're taking out, there are no tax withholdings, but you do have to pay taxes. So if you want to take out 100 shares of BCE, you can do that. There's no taxes withheld on that. If you're taking money out of an RRSP, there is tax withheld on every withdrawal from your RRSP. So you need to factor that in making that withdrawal. If you decide that you're going to take out $20,000 from your RRSP in stocks, then there's going to be a 30% withholding tax, or $6,000 would go to the government. So the government doesn't take stock in payment of your tax withholdings, so you have to send them cash. That means you'll have to have some cash in your RRSP to submit to the government while you take the shares out. So if we had bought these Scotiabank shares in the RRSP on January 16th, now they're worth $17,000. I could choose to withdraw those 250 shares in kind. If it's in my RRSP, I now have to remit $7,633 to the government. So my withdrawal is going to be closer to $30,000. $23,000 coming to me in those Scotiabank shares, $7,600 going to the government to pay my taxes on my withdrawal. Depending on which tax bracket I'm in, I might still have to pay a little bit more tax when I file my tax return, because if I'm in the 36% tax bracket and they're only withholding 30, then I should expect to pay more in April, okay? So the withholding tax is always a temporary tax. When you file your tax return, that's when you'll know what the correct amount of tax is. What's the benefit? Well, the benefit is that $5,500 that you, quote, lost on your Scotiabank shares, you'll never have to pay taxes on that. That money's gone. You don't have to pay taxes on money that you don't have. Well, you might not see the humor in that, but the fact is you still owe those Scotiabank shares. So if those Scotiabank shares go back up, then when they go back up, that recovery will be taxed as a capital gain instead of as a fully taxable withdrawal from your RRSP or RRIF at some point in the future. So I can take something that would be 100% taxable and convert it to a capital gain that is only 50% taxable currently. So I can win by never having to pay taxes on that $5,500. And if I do make the $5,500 back, then I'll only pay tax on half of it. So if you have to take money out of your RRSP or RRIF, you don't have to take money out of your RRSP, but you might choose to take money out of your RRSP. You might choose to take it out in kind so that when the recovery comes, you won't have to pay quite as much tax. Now, if you've got money or contribution room available in your TFSA, then it makes even more sense to take the money out of your RRSP, put it in the TFSA, so that when the recovery comes, you won't pay tax on any of that recovery. So if we're using our example of XGRO, you might have paid $26,000 for those in your RRSP earlier this year. Right now, you might sell enough of your XGRO to realize, or sell enough EGRO for $10,000. Make that withdrawal from your RRSP, there would be a 20% withholding tax. You then have $8,000 that you can put into your TFSA and buy back shares of XGRO. Now, I went through the process of selling and buying back as opposed to making a withdrawal in kind, but you could withdraw $10,000, $8,000 in XGRO, and $2,000 in the withholding tax to the government. The benefit is that $1,500 that you lost, never have to pay tax on that in the future. And if XGRO goes back up, then it will be in your TFSA and there will be no tax on the recovery. So you're going to win and win in that case. Well, maybe not. You just didn't want to lose it in the first place, right? What if you don't have TFSA contribution room? Well, now we can talk about taking the money out of the RRSP when the market is low and investing that money outside of your RRSP and earning tax-efficient income. So we need to know what the difference tax rates are on interest, dividends, or capital gains. And another way of tax-efficient investing is to have the partner who is in the lower tax bracket do the investing. So that's maybe not always the same person who has money in the RRSP, but we'll take a look at opportunities for tax-efficient investing. So here's that chart I was telling you a little about earlier. The marginal tax rates this year on the first $50,197, everybody in Alberta will pay 10% provincial tax, 15% federal tax, for a total of 25%. Now that's the tax rate on the last dollar of income that you earned. So if you made $50,000, one more dollar would be taxed at 25 cents. Once you're into the next tax bracket, doesn't change the tax rates on the first $50,000, but the next dollar is then going to be taxed federally at 20.5%, provincially 10, so a total of 30.5%. So you're now into a slightly higher tax bracket. That tax bracket lasts all the way through to $100,392. So if you're making $60,000 now, and you take another $10,000 out of your RRSP, the tax rate will be 30.5%, or on $10,000, $3,050. If you take out $20,000, the tax rate is the same, 30.5%. If you take out $30,000, the tax rate is the same, 30.5%. So you have to decide how much do you want to take out before you go into the next higher tax bracket. So that next higher tax bracket, $100,393 up to $134,000, is now taxed at 36%. You may say, oh, no, I don't want to pay 36. Maybe I'll pay 30.5. So you can decide how much you want to draw out and stay in whichever tax bracket you're comfortable with. Some of you might be in higher tax brackets still, and you can see that the tax rates go up. If there's two in your family, one of you making $150,000, one of you making less than $50,000, which one should be doing the investing? That answer is the person who is in the lower tax bracket should be the one doing the investing, because whatever kind of investments they buy, they will pay less tax on their investment income than a person in a higher tax bracket, okay? Now, let's talk about the difference between interest, dividends, and capital gains. Interest income is taxed at your marginal tax rate. When you lend money to the bank pays you interest on that GIC, and the bank gets a tax deduction for paying you the interest. So when the bank gets a tax deduction for paying you the interest, guess what that means? You have to pay tax on the interest that you are receiving. If you buy shares of the bank and they pay you a dividend, the bank borrows money from other people with GICs, lends it to other people on mortgages, they make a profit, they pay taxes in Canada on that profit, and out of their profits they then pay you a dividend, a share of those profits. So the dividends that you receive from one of the Canadian banks has already been taxed. So the government doesn't want to tax it again at your marginal tax rate. So there's a complicated system of dividend gross up and tax credit. I'll give you an example of that in a minute. But the effective tax rate on dividends is less than the tax rate on interest because the dividends have already been taxed once. If those shares go up in value from this low point now, eventually you will have a capital gain. A gain right now, one half of that gain is taxable, so the effective tax rates on capital gains is half that of interest or other fully taxable income. Just to be aware, the dividends that we're talking about here are eligible dividends, which means they came from a large Canadian corporation. That might be a pipeline company, that might be a telecommunications company, it might be a bank, it might be an insurance company, but it's a Canadian large company. Foreign large dividend-paying companies fall into this category. Dividends from foreign companies, their profits have not been taxed in Canada. So when you receive a dividend from that foreign company, then you have to pay the full rate of tax in Canada on that income. So the red here indicates the highest tax rate. The green is the lowest tax rate. So depending on which tax bracket you fall into, dividends or capital gains are taxed at a lower rate than interest. So this is how it works on your tax return. When you receive a T5 slip that says $1,000 of interest, that becomes your taxable income. If you're in the 30.5% tax bracket, you pay $205 of federal tax and $100 of provincial tax for a total of $305. If you received $1,000 of dividends from, say, TELUS, on your tax return, on your T5 slip, it's going to show $1,000 of actual dividends, but $1,380 of taxable dividends. So the dividends are grossed up. The intention is to make the $1,380 or the $1,000 increase to $1,380 so that if you were TELUS, your profit would have been $1,380. The government then wants to tax you at your tax rate on that $1,380. So in this case, $282, but you then get a tax credit for the amount of tax that the corporation has paid. So TELUS has already paid taxes, and there you get to claim that as a tax credit on your tax return. So that means your federal taxes are $75, provincial tax $25, a total of $105, or technically 10.5% in that second tax bracket. Capital gains, your T5008, the form that tells the government that you sold some investments. If you have a $1,000 capital gain, you only have to claim one half of that on your tax return, or $500. So we then go through that calculation. I have to pay 30.5% on my $500, which works out to $152.50. So the benefit of owning Canadian dividend-paying stocks outside of your tax shelter plan is that you pay less tax on the dividends, you pay less tax on future profits. After you've claimed your capital loss this year, we anticipate that you'll have profits in the future, right? Okay, so let's take a look at a couple of different choices today. You can buy, well, last month, you could have bought a Scotiabank GIC for 4.6%, earning $460 of interest. If you're in that second tax bracket, you pay $140 of tax, and your after-tax return, $320, or over the next 5 years, 3.2% per year. You could have bought Scotiabank stock, so $10,000 of Scotiabank stock, 140 shares at $71.25. You will earn $577 of dividends based on today's dividend amount. On that, you'd pay $59 of tax. So over each year, you would receive $518 or 5.18% after tax over the next 5 years. Now, that doesn't take into account the possibility of Scotiabank shares going up instead of down. And it doesn't take into account dividend increases. At the beginning of the year, Scotiabank was paying it's paying $4.12 now, so there's been a 3% increase just this year. 5 years ago, Scotiabank was paying $3.04 a dividend, now it's $4.12, so that's a 35% increase over the last 5 years of their dividends. So, how much has inflation been over 5 years? High this year, for sure. So typically, about 2% per year over those previous 4 years. So Scotiabank dividends have increased faster than the rate of inflation. Not saying it's a good stock, that's something for Evan to talk about. But it makes a good example. Now, if those choices are in your RRSP or outside of your RRSP, let's take a look at the tax consequences. If you've got this five-year GIC in your RRSP earning 4.6%, if you leave it in there, then 5 years from now, it will be worth $12,522. And you'll pay taxes then of $3,819, and you'll have $8,702 to spend in the future. If you take the money out of your RRSP now, pay that $3,050 of tax, invest it, the $6,950 in that GIC, then your future earnings will be this 3.2% after tax. So 5 years from now, you'll have $8,136 to spend. So when we're talking about interest-bearing investments, if you're going to be in the same tax bracket at some point in the future as what you're in now, there's no significant benefit of taking the money out of the RRSP right now. If tax rates increase, then we'll see that maybe there's an advantage to do that. But if you're in the same tax bracket, no significant benefit. If we put the money into a tax-free savings account, pay our $3,000 now, earn that 4.6%, then 5 years from now, I will have exactly the same amount of spending money. So if I'm in the same tax bracket, taking the money out of the RRSP, buying exactly the same investment in my TFSA, I will be equal. There's no tax benefit of doing so, other than I might feel that I've done better because the money is in my TFSA. Now, let's take a look at your, in this case, Scotiabank shares in your RRSP. If you leave them in there, then their growth from $10,000 now to $14,000, paying the taxes then, you'll have $9,895, so more than with the GIC. If you take the money out of your RRSP now and invest it, then you'll have $9,535. So you can see there's not that much difference between leaving the stock in the RRSP versus taking it out now. If there's a greater increase in the capital gain, if there are increases on dividends, then there will be a bigger advantage of owning that stock outside of your RRSP than inside of your RRSP. So I had to deal with the numbers that I plugged in. Right now, this 10% capital gain, only one half taxable, isn't quite enough to take care of the tax deferral that you would have in your RRSP. Now, if we take the money out of the RRSP, put it in the TFSA, then we'll have exactly the same amount of money to spend in the future because the taxes pay the 30.5% now, pay the 30.5% later. It's the same number of dollars. Let's compare the GIC in your RRSP, which we saw earlier, would grow to $8,702 of spending money in 5 years' time, versus taking it out of the RRSP and buying that equity investment. Now I've got $9,535 to spend 5 years from now versus $8,702 to spend 5 years from now. So here we're seeing an advantage. So if you are considering taking money out of your RRSP and just buying another GIC, then maybe that's not the right option. But if you're thinking about taking the money out of the RRSP and buying an investment that may increase in value, that does pay income by way of eligible dividends, then there may be an advantage for you compared to just buying another GIC, okay? And now, what if tax rates go up? How many people think that tax rates are going to go down in the future? No hands, okay? I won't ask how many think will go up, but we're pretty sure they're not going to go down. So why might tax rates increase? Not just because the government says we're going to increase rates, but you might earn more income in the future. Oh, how could that possibly be? Well, if you're already retired, but not yet receiving your CPP or old age security, then for sure your income is going to increase as those other pensions kick in. If you're already receiving your CPP and old age security, but you haven't started your RRIF yet, then eventually you have to transfer your RRSP to a RRIF and begin to receive income from that. So for some of you, there will be increases to your income in the future. Now, will that put you in a different tax bracket? That's hard to say, but chances are some of you will have greater income in the future. There is another issue. Not just going into a different tax bracket, but having some of your social benefits clawed back. So the social benefit that we will talk about here is old age security. It is a benefit paid to everybody over the age of 65. If you make too much money, then they want that money back. When you start your old age security, I should say that, when you turn 65, there is an age exemption, which is supposed to offset the tax that you would otherwise have to pay on your old age security. But if you make too much money, they take that age exemption away as well. So these are clawbacks of social benefits that effectively increase your tax rate. And the last thing that will happen for those of you who do have partners is that eventually one of you is going to die. Eventually, both of you will die. That one of you will die first, and the one who survives is going to receive all of the income. And there's no opportunity of sharing investment income, having the spouse with the lower income pay the taxes on the investment income. There won't be any opportunity of sharing pension income. So the survivor may be in a higher tax bracket once one of you dies. So the clawbacks that we'll talk about your old age security, if you make more than $81,761, you have to pay back 15 cents for every dollar that you earn above that. And if you make more than $133,000, it's all clawed back. So they just won't pay it to you in the first place. Now, the age exemption is clawed back if you make more than $39,000. So many of my clients will earn more than $39,000 and will not get all of their age exemption. And so let's see, let's take an example of that. I didn't do that transition very well, did I? So if your spouse has died and your income is $91,761, exactly $10,000 over the threshold, you now have to pay back $1,500 of your old age security. So that $1,500 is effectively a tax deduction. If I didn't receive it, I don't have to pay taxes on it. But the other $8,500, the amount above $81,000, is still taxable at my 30.5% tax rate. So the combined tax and clawback works out to be $4,090, or a tax rate of just under 41%. So I could be happily making $90,000 before age 65, paying 30.5% tax. Now, after 65, I'm making $90,000, and my effective tax rate on the last dollar is 41%. What happened?
I turned 65 and started my CPP, or old age security, sorry.
Well, that's not fair. What can you do about this? Well, you could acquire another spouse and share some of your pension income with them. I'm trying to do that, but no success so far. But if you don't have a spouse, then you're kind of hooped, aren't you? There isn't any way of sharing your income with anybody else. You might, in future years, give away some of that money that's causing all of this problem, or not. But if your net income is that $91,000, then you have to pay back some of your old age security. So for those people who are receiving old age security, these red numbers are the effective tax rates, taking into account the loss of the age exemption here and the loss of your old age security in those last two red numbers. So you can see that after you are receiving old age security, your tax rate may be higher than before age 65. So again, I encourage people to take money out of their RRSPs before they're 65 so that they pay the tax rate at the current 30.5%, for argument's sake. So let's take a look at an example. If I've got that GIC in my RRSP and I leave it in there until I'm after 65, when I take it out, I'll have $7,401 left to spend. If I take the money out now when I'm in the 30.5% tax bracket, even if I only earn the after-tax 3.2%, I've actually got more money to spend 5 years from now because I chose to pay the tax now at my lower rate than sometime later at a potentially higher rate. So tax planning, from my perspective, is paying the least amount of tax over your lifetime, not less tax now and a whole bunch of tax later. It's smoothing it out over your lifetime. If we were to take that money, put it into the TFSA, then we're even better off, for sure. What about the stock? Same thing. I'm better off taking the stock out of the RRSP now, paying the taxes at 30.5%, than leaving it in there and paying taxes at 41% in the future. Put it in my TFSA, it's better, but certainly if I've got the opportunity of drawing the money out of the RRSP now and investing it in my non-registered account, I'll have a lot more money as a result of making that change. Excellent. Better to have money in my TFSA than in my non-registered account, but as you're aware, there's a limit in terms of how much you can put into your TFSA, and I presume that you're trying as much as possible to get the money in the TFSA. In an ideal world, the money in your TFSA would only go up in value. Mine's not. Mine's going in the other direction, but I have faith in those companies. So 5 years from now, I would anticipate that my TFSA will have recovered and all of my profits will be tax-free. So I think I'm just about out of time. So what I've tried to present to you are some opportunities. The market certainly is going through some fluctuations. The market is down from where it was earlier this year or last year. Are there opportunities that can be created from that? So we talked about selling some of your stocks, creating a loss, carrying that loss back, getting back some taxes in the past or from the past, and then potentially investing that money in a fashion that if the market does recover, you will still benefit somehow. We talked about taking money out of the RRSP and specifically drawing the money out now when the markets are lower and investing or keeping those investments now outside of your RRSP or in your TFSA. And generally, if you are going to invest outside of those tax sheltered plans, and some of you will have money there, some of you may inherit money that will stay there, and the opportunity exists to decide, do I want to put that money into a GIC and pay tax on the interest, or do I want to own a stock that pays dividends and pay taxes on the dividends and potentially see that investment go down and down and down in value until it turns around, comes back up sometime in the next 5 years. So that's it for me. I appreciate that you didn't ask any questions. I was going to say that you could, but it's a good thing you didn't because its timing is coming to an end here. But we are going to have a break before Evan talks. So are there any questions about what I've talked about on the tax side? No, good, clear as mud. Excellent. No, if you do, just come and see me. We're going to have a break for about 15 minutes. Is that what you planned? Okay. So it's 8 o'clock. We'll start again at 8:15, and we'll call. I will then call Taylor and Evan up to talk about stocks. Thanks. Thank you very much, and I'll be hanging around. Ask any questions anytime you want.